Good afternoon, friends. So in this lecture of marketing research, we will study about scales and measurement. In the last two or three lectures, we have discussed about what is marketing research, how it is applicable to the industry. Then what are the different types of marketing research? Basically, broad types are exploratory and causal research. Exploratory research explore the causes, explore the problems, and descriptive or causal research are generally describe the causes or the symptoms behind it. Then in the previous classes we have understand how to formulate a problem, what are the processes to formulate a problem. In that we have go through some of the series of steps which say that first of all you have to identify the problem, then you have to define the problem, and then for definition of the problem you can use some theories, established theories that already have studied that problem in the past. Then based on that theory you develop some research model, or the research model can be of different types, the graphical model or the simple verbal model or mathematical model. So based on this research models and theories established in the past, you develop or you post out some research question which your objective or your research is tend to solve. Now based on that research questions, you develop an hypothesis. Now based on that hypothesis, you propose some statistical tool or statistical techniques that could be applied for your data. Now in this step, when you are up to the data collection, you require some knowledge of how to measure the particular response, how to measure the particular attitude. For this, you require the measurement scale, the knowledge of scales and measurement scale. The difference between measurement and scale is simple. Measurement is generally a particular value that come out when you and give a particular thing, or measure a particular thing with a given scale. So that is the basic difference between the measurement and the scale. Now, in the explanation of the scale, we describe two aspects of the scale. First is what are the different scale types, and before going for describing the scale type, we will first discuss what are the different primary scales. So in scale, we will describe about the primary scales, and then later on we will describe the type of the scale. There are 3-4 types of primary scale. I just described also the primary type of primary scale with a simple example. Suppose we are organizing a kind of race, tracking race of 100 meter, and there are 4 participants, 4 racers are there. For convenience, I label them A, B, C, D. And suppose this is the finish line, the distance is 100 meter. So after the race, I also calculate the time in suppose seconds. So when the race is completed, I calculate the time in seconds for each participant, each 4 participants. Suppose that time comes to be for A is about 8.5, B is about 7.5, this is 8, and this is 9.5. Okay. So based on this time, I can obviously declare the position of the racers, who was the first, who was the second, who was the third, and who was the fourth. So based on the time, I declare this as the first, this as the second, A is for third position, and D is for fourth position. After the race, I want to conduct a kind of survey of one of the respondent or one of the viewers. Suppose I choose 100 viewers from that of the race, and then give the viewers as a question that between 1 to 10, if you want to rate this, these races between 1 to 10, what do you give to these each races? Suppose with this, in a scale of 1 to 10, just give 9, score 9.5, score 7, score 5. So these are the output of that survey, where I asked the viewers or the person who watched the race to find out, to rate the racers in a particular interval of scale. Now with this, what I want to do, I want to give the responses in a range of 1 to 10. Now from this example, a simple example, we can understand the basic differences between the primary scales. Now the primary scales, when I capture the actual responses, the actual values or actual points, that kind of scale is called a ratio scale. So when I capture the actual responses, the actual values, then that type of response or that type of measurement is called ratio scale. Now suppose if for a questionnaire, if I ask the respondent its age, is or her age, then that age value, suppose it's 15 or 16 or 25, that values become the ratio scales. Now based on that, this time in second, I order the racers or I position the racers first, second, third and fourth. So I make a rank of it. So this type of scale is called a rank scale or ordinal scale. So this type of scale is called rank scale or ordinal scale. When from the given values, what I done, I rank the racers according to the first, second, third and positions. So for a particular given values, when I rank the outputs, then it's called a rank or ordinal scale. In this third type of scale, what I have done, I have asked the respondent to scale or to rate the racers from 1 to 10. So that type, I bound the respondent to answer between from 1 value to 10 value. So that I make it an interval. So when I make some respondent or make the, you can say, output from a particular scale or interval, that type of scale is called interval scale. So interval scale, when you ask the respondent between fixed two points, minimum or maximum scales, so that type of scale is called interval scale. The first thing what I have done in this kind of racing example is I labeled the four races. And that label can be their name, the label can be their surname, the label can watch, I feel like A, B, C, D. Their label can be any number, A 123, B 123, C 123, any number. So when you label some entities to just identify them, that type of scale is called a nominal scale. So that type of scale is called nominal scale. When you nominate some kind of labels to the each identifiers, to each alternators or each items which you are scaling, measuring. So these are different kinds of primary scale. When I further distinguish between this types of scale, ratio is the most good measurement when you want to apply all mathematical or statistical functions. So ratio is the best scale when you want to apply all mathematical or statistical functions. Rank In the later sections, we will describe about the parametric and non-parametric test. So rank is a kind of non-parametric values which came out. So there is a some set of limited statistical technique which can be applied in a rank kind of scale. Interval, I can only perform mean, standard deviations, and some kind of inferential statistics. But the nominal is the scale where the least function or least mathematical function or statistical function can be applied. Only those functions or those techniques which capture the frequency data, because in this, when I label something, I can only calculate the frequencies, I can only calculate the counts, and that count can be further generated into percentage or something else. But the tests which is best suitable for this kind of scale is generally the chi-square test or some non-parametric test. So if I want to apply majority of statistical tests or mathematical functions on a particular value, then I have to capture that value in a ratio scale or interval scale. Interval scale is generally most popular in those research where we want to calculate or we want to capture the correspondent or the respondent attitude or behavior. In this type of a scale, I bound the respondent to respect or respond to a particular interval. There are two, one minimum and one maximum values. So when I arrange this, so this is the least one, and then this is the most appropriate scale where the functions can be applied. Why we are studying this scale types or primary scale types? Because when you use some statistical software, when you use some statistical software like SPSS, then the SPSS asks about the data type. Where suppose you want to store age, then the SPSS asks what the age, what type of data you are storing in the age variable. So if you are storing age as a actual value, then you have to apply ratio. You have to mention the ratio scale. When you apply age in a bracket kind of thing, in an age bracket, suppose if I apply age like 10 to 15, 16 to 20 or 21 to 25, how can I store the data? I can just label it like 1, 2, 3 or A, B or C. So when I label this data, it becomes nominal. When I store this data in an Excel or an SPSS format, then I have to label this as a, then I have to mention it as a nominal scale. When I capture the attitude in an interval scale, then I have to mention in SPSS, then this data, suppose I was the most favorite bike you have, then the most favorite, do you like the, this bike, particular bike, then you have to rate that responses into interval scale. So when you capture this data, you have to mention that data is a kind of interval scale. When the data is of count of rank, then you have to mention in SPSS that it is an ordinal kind of data. So that is why it is important to understand the importance of primary skills, knowledge of the primary skills. When we further study the scale types, there are two basic types of scales, comparative and non-comparative scales. Comparative and non-comparative scales. We can further classify this comparative scales paired comparison scale rank order scale when constant sum is k. When I further classify this non-comparator, the non-comparator can be 2 continuous rating scale itemized rating scale. When further classify this itemized rating scale popularly, the most popular itemized rating scale is Likert scale, LIKERT, Likert scale. Another is semantic differential. Semantic differential scale. And another is Staple scale. These are basic types of scales. Comparative scales are those scales where you want to compare between two or more values. If you are comparing between two different alternatives, that is called a paired comparison. If you are making a pairs of it, when you are comparing more than three or four alternatives and you want to rank them, those alternatives or those categories, then rank order scale. On constant sum scale, you can compare this particular identified categories by giving some points to the respondent and he has to distribute those points. The non-comparative scale, I am not making any comparisons. I am not making any comparison between two or more alternatives. I want to get out the basic response from the respondent on a particular, you can say, statement or the declaration. In that declaration, one is called continuous rating scale. When I choose the respondent to respond in a continuous line and he has to mark in a continuous line. In itemized rating scale, the line is further divided into sections and that each section is labeled. So when each section is labeled, that's called itemized rating scale. So most popular are Likert, semantic, and Staple. Likert. This name is came from the originator who developed this scale. Semantic differential, in which the two different poles are arranged and the respondent has to mark between these two poles. Staple has a quality of capturing the responses both on a positive and a negative side. I just further describe this each scale type. First, start with the comparative one. When I show paired comparison, what happens in the paired comparison? I make a matrix of alternative to the respondent. Suppose there are four alternatives A, B, C, and D. So I arrange these four alternatives in the column also A, B, C, and D, and I present this as a matrix. It is very important that you give an instruction to the respondent and how to fill this scale. So in this instruction we write, in a paired comparison instruction we write that the user has to fill the entries either 1 or 0. When you have to enter 1, you have to enter 1 when this when a particular alternative is preferred over the others. So if I prefer A over rest of all, then I make 1 or else 0. And subsequently, for every column, you have to make entry. So suppose I make this kind of entry. Next part is how to interpret this skill. Now, to interpret this skill, you just only have to sum the columns. So if I sum the column here, it comes to be 1. If I sum the column here, this is 3, this is 0, and this is 0. So the basic interpretation of the basic result came out from this exercise is that the product B is the most preferred brand or preferred alternative or preferred product, if I arrange the product or I arrange the brand or I arrange the alternatives, over the rest of the given choices. The marketing implication of this kind of research or this kind of scale is that the marketer or the company is able to make the pairs out of it. How to make pairs? Then if suppose I want to bundle any two products of the same company and launch in the market, or sometimes when the sales are going down, the company is trying to sell the less popular item to the most popular item and bundle them. So here the indications, here the result can give me a view that if I bundle this B with A, it is a possibility of selling. I cannot bundle this A or B either with C or D. And give an inference, it will give the perspective of bundle sale, selling. So this is a paired comparison. In the next comparison scale, if we sum up the basic disadvantage of this scale, when the choices are more, the cognitive or the mental effort to the respondent is more, then the scale become quite cumbersome and time consuming to enter the village. Next scale is rank order. It's simple. You provide the alternative. Suppose there are 5 alternatives, and in instruction you write that the respondent has to fill or rank this alternative according to their preferences. So it can be a brand of, you know, different brands of chocolate, different brands of detergent, navy cement, anyone. So it's very simple. Your user has to rank the given choices. So it is the most simple arrangement of measuring or capturing the ranks and comparing between the alternatives or the given choices. The basic disadvantage of this scale is that when the choices are more than 3 or 4 or 5, then the mental effort by the respondent increases, and when the mental effort increases, it may be the possibility that the respondent refuses to fill this scale. The next is constant sum. In a constant sum scale, what happens? Suppose there are 4 alternatives A, B, C, D. Suppose these 4 are maybe the examples, maybe the different small car models. So this may be the Maruti, this can be the Hyundai, this can be the Chevrolet, this can be the Renault. So based on some criteria, you ask the respondent. Suppose based on fuel efficiency, based on price, based on comfort, I ask the respondent to fill this matrix. And what is the difference? I assign a set of constant sum of points to each given alternative. Suppose I assign 100 points to each alternative. So what the respondent has to do? Respondent has to distribute this 100 point on these criteria and distribute. Suppose respondent fill like this. I assign 50 marks or 50 points out of 100 to the fuel efficiency. In this I assign this 50, this is 60, this is 70, and the remaining I distribute like this. Out of 50 I like this. And the remaining are filled in. So what is the advantage? How I calculate the However, I calculate the total, just total the sum values, column values, and the model or the iterator who scored the highest, you can assign, check by the row that for which category the respondent scored the highest value. Suppose for in fuel efficiency, the model C is the leader. In price efficiency, model D is the leader. In comfort, model suppose D is the leader. But the basic disadvantage of this scale, when the choices in the rows and choices in the column increases, when the scale becomes too large, then it becomes complex. Second basic advantage, when you assign a constant sum to a point or to the respondent, then he has to do some mathematical calculation. Suppose I assign 50 points to that, and then put remaining points to another, then remaining points to another. That mathematical calculation plus and minus you do. So this is the basic disadvantage of this scale. When the complexity arises, when the scale becomes too large, then it requires more time consuming and mental effort to enter. The next scale, we will compare the non-comparative ones. Non-comparative scales are basically two types, the continuous rating scale and the itemized rating scale. We first go for the continuous rating scale. What happens in a continuous rating scale, you present a particular declaration or a statement to the respondent. Suppose I am satisfied with the overall service. Suppose for a hotel industry or for a restaurant or any service industry like banks and all, I am filling out a questionnaire and there is a declarative or some statement that says that the respondent or the customer is satisfied with the overall service of the provider, maybe the bank or restaurant or hotel or any service industry. So in a continuous rating scale, when I measure this, I make two rows of responses. Suppose this one is not at all satisfied. And this is very much satisfied. So what I made the two extreme responses, two extreme alternatives to the respondent, and then I make a straight line between these two. And subsequently for each person, I make the same scheme. In an instruction, what I write, that please mark your agreement or disagreement of this declarative statement on this scale by indicating a mark in this. So suppose one respondent mark here, for another person, another respondent mark here. And how I compare between the responses, calculating this distance between the starting and the mark. But sometimes when the distance between the marks are very less and it's very hard to distinguish between these two scale or these two points, then the measurement become an issue. So continuous rating scale is easy to design, but the conversion of this scale or the marks into the numeric values or numeric conversion is very hard. Next type of scale, the same response, when I go for itemized rating scale, the first one is likelihood scale. So for the same question, for the same statement, when I convert this scale into likelihood rating scale, so Likert rating scale says that your interval should be or the responses should be in odd numbers, and you have to label the each response. So if I make this as a first, and this is the extreme left and extreme right, then I have to break this whole scale. Into some odd interval. So suppose I make 5-point Likert scale, so 5 intervals should be there. So one is extreme right and one is extreme left, and then in middle values you have to write the response. Suppose the middle value has no idea scale, no idea point, where the respondent is don't know about whether the statement is true or false. And this is, suppose this is towards the negative side, not at all satisfied. So you are somewhat not satisfied, you are not satisfied. Very much satisfied, too satisfied. So this becomes like this. So when I convert this number, I convert this response into number. Suppose it is a 5-point Likert scale. So from very much satisfied, I start with 4, then 3, then 2. I can also reverse the order, 1, 2, 3, 4, not at all satisfied to the very satisfied. So itemized or Likert scattering scale says that you have to divide the interval into odd points, odd interval maybe the 5 or 7, and then you have to give labels to this each intervals. If I convert this scale into semantic differential, semantic differential, same those two points. Suppose I write here not satisfied, I'm not at all satisfied. Here I write very much satisfied. So semantic differential says that you make the two responses in the opposite pole and then you mark the intervals. What happened here? I mark the scale with this distinction, and then when the respondent respond to this scale, they only has to tick where he has to mark. Next is a staple scale. In this scale, the advantage is that you can capture the positive and the negative responses, extreme positive and extreme negative. Suppose you are doing a survey on product quality, then you can always make a base scale. Suppose I make a base scale of poor quality, and then the extreme positive responses and extreme negative responses should be there. So suppose I make this poor quality as a 0, so I make 5 points above from this poor quality or the base scale 0, then 5 points above, and then I make negative responses or negative outcomes as a negative value. So this becomes a stable scale. So the advantage is that I can capture the most extreme positive and extreme negative. The basic disadvantage here is that the layout is very space consuming, and this scale is not suitable when you are not trying to gather the negative, extreme negative responses. when I try to measure the quality on based on only poor to the positive, then this scale is important. Now this scale can be used. So this is about scale types. So we understand what are the different primary scales. Primary scales are generally categorized as nominal when you label the items. When you capture the actual values, that is a ratio scale. When you ask the respondent to respond on a particular interval of values or minimum or maximum values, it becomes an interval scale. When you rank or when you order the values, it becomes a ranked scale or ordinal scale. Based on the scale types, there are two basically scale types: comparative scales and non-comparative scales. Comparative scales, when you are intend to compare between the two or more alternatives, and non-comparative, when I am not interested in making comparisons, I only want the responses based on my given statement. In a non-comparative scales, some scales are generally bipolar, having only bipolar responses, in which the respondent has to indicate the response. In a Likert or an itemized rating scale, the intervals are labeled. The next feature or next topic related to scale is its reliability and validity. So scale has two basic types. Scale reliability and scale validity. Validity has, you can examine the content validity, you can examine the criteria validity, and you can examine the construct validity. In the reliability, there are basically three kind of tests. One is test retest, alternative form test, and internal consistency. When I start with this reliability concept, there are three basic types: test and retest method, in which the scale values are tested over a long period of time. Suppose you developed a questionnaire which has some set of questions, and the responses are measured in Likert form. And these are statements. Suppose you make this statement or this scale, when you want to examine the reliability, in the first test, test and retest, you first apply this scale or circulate this questionnaire to a set of 10 people or 12 people or 15 respondents, and then you gather the response. And after some time, maybe the month or maybe 2 months later, you again circulate the same questionnaire to that same respondent or 15 respondents, and then check the response. If these two responses matches, it means the scale is reliable and the scale is able to capture the same kind of responses at the two different times, a given time. What does it mean? That the scale doesn't influence the respondent, or the respondent does not change according to the scale times. So this is a test retest. When you test the scale by retesting it over a period of time, and after 2-3 iterations, you confirm that the scale is reliable. In the alternative forms, suppose I make this all statement in a positive direction. Suppose I am satisfied with the service, I am satisfied with the facilities, physical facilities, I am satisfied with the, suppose in the case of online banking, I am satisfied with the online banking websites of the particular bank. So these all statements are in a positive direction. The responses are captured, and then when I change this form of this statement into the negative side, that I am not satisfied with the service, I am not satisfied with the facilities or infrastructure facilities of the bank, I am not satisfied with the website of quality of the bank and for the internet transactions, then these statements are further tested for the responses. So this alternate form says, then you compare this two responses, and these two responses should be opposite to each other, because you have changed the forms. One responses are for the positive statement and one responses are for the negative statement. So these two responses should be positive. So when these two responses for those two forms are consistent, then we can say the scale is reliable to capture the positive and negative responses. In the internal consistency, I generally divide this scale into basically two parts and try to capture or try to analyze these two responses, two half responses, and get out some mathematical value to internally test the consistency. The most popular method of calculating or analyzing this internal consistency is Cronbach alpha. Most statistical tools like SPSS provide this Cronbach alpha value when you test the reliability of the scale. General expectable of threshold of this scale is 0.7. If your alpha value of your scale value is greater than 0.7, the scale is declared to be a reliable scale. When I come to the scale validity part, first the content validity, I check the scales or the questions I ask or the statement I ask to the set of experts, industry experts or domain expert, the set of some respondent, initial respondent. Suppose my sample size is 300, then I took 15 to 20 initial respondent to check whether the questions are in the right form, whether there is a grammatical mistake or some you can say form mistake, whether this questions are not intentionally asking that what I want to discuss or what I want to, that data will be captured. So that is called content validity. I ask the content of this scale, I check the content of the scale, and when this content is has been verified by the experts or the pilot questionnaire or pilot survey of my respondent, then I declare that this scale is valid. Another is criteria validity. Criteria validity means that the scale is co-designed to measure a specific construct. Suppose I am measuring satisfaction, then my scale values or the question I ask or that statement I ask should only measure that satisfaction part. Now that satisfaction, suppose I want to measure shopping satisfaction or shopping experience satisfaction, then my subsequent question should ask about the service, about the payment options, about the after sale services. So that is called criterion validity. It means the scales are validated whether these scales are measuring the same criteria, the same reference criteria which you are intending to measure. So this can also be done by this expert or industry expert or the domain expert or some pilot survey or focus group. The last one is construct validity. Construct validities are further divided into two: convergent validity and discriminant validity. Convergent validity means that suppose you are asking for satisfaction, suppose online purchase satisfaction. So convergent validity means that when you are measuring this satisfaction, then suppose you assume that this satisfaction is derived from the quality service, the price you have, the after sale service, packaging. So when you develop this model, it means these are the measurement scale and this become the latent variable. Now when you measure this latent variable based on this observed variable or this observed measures, then the convergent validity assumes that these measures or these observed variable are intently measured the satisfaction and not overlapping with other constraints. Discriminant validity says that these measures, these observed variables are not interrelated. Means if you assume four observed variables, then these observed variables are not interrelated. They are all distinct from each other. This means discriminant validity. So this, up to this we have finished this scales and measurement. We have discussed that the kind of primary scales, the types of scales, there are two types of scales, and this scale validity and reliability. In the next lecture, we will continue with this scales and questionnaire design.